Hey, Griot fam, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are here with Dr. Rob Gore, who is an emergency room physician at Kings County Hospital in Brooklyn, New York. He is also the executive director and founder of CAVI, which is a nonprofit organization that he founded in 2009. So welcome, Dr. Gore.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. So tell us about CAVI and what it's all about and what it stands for.
And what it stands for. So CAVI itself is a hospital, school, and community-based violence intervention program. We want to make sure that young people who are affected and impacted by violence and trauma see something else. When you've been injured and you come from certain neighborhoods, you know, violence and trauma is something that's expected. It's almost a rite of passage, but we all know that there are other options. And we want to make sure that we give young people who've been impacted and their families, we want to give them the tools to do other things, whether it's be able to go to school, whether it's be able to, you know, go on to college, seek employment, and really just heal from traumatic experiences. In the hospital program, we work with people who've been shot and stabbed. We're at Kings County and SUNY Downstate, so I got to give a shout out to SUNY
Both
Downstate. And the two hospitals are across the street from each other, even though people kind of think it's the same thing. But we work with people who've been injured as a result of violent trauma and help link them up with psychosocial support systems, everything from mental health services to helping find a safe haven because, you know, you've been injured. You want to make sure that you don't have to go back to the same place that's traumatized you or else you're going to wind up coming back. And about 40 to 50% of people do come back after they've been injured. Our school programs and community school programs are a little bit different. And a lot of the students and young people that we work with are high school age or middle school age kids, and we've got over 250 kids in those programs. We have an entire curriculum that focuses on mediation and conflict resolution and skill and idea development. But in addition to that, we're incorporating restorative justice practices, understanding oppression, understanding poverty, understanding all these different elements that are like social determinants which impact and influence our health and wellness, but wanting to make sure we have this healing approach just to target these issues. You know, I tell people, you know, people say, oh, wow, it's great. You know, you're a doc and you get a chance to save lives. I'm like, yeah, that's real cool, but people don't have to become patients. And we want to make this be a lot more preemptive in helping fix these issues instead of just providing band-aids to the issues of violence and trauma.
So a big part of what you just talked about was not only healing the body, but healing the mind.
Yes.
Can you explain a little bit more why that's so important in the resolution process?
Right. So when somebody has any kind of injury, whether it's violent, accidental, you're going to go through a particular stress period, especially if you know, your mobility is compromised, if your ability to do your regular activities of daily living have shifted because you've got a broken arm or a broken leg or a broken ankle or paralyzed from the waist below. It takes a toll on the body. And when things like that have happened and you get discharged from the hospital, you are often discharged back to the community in which it took place to begin with. And whether the suspect who, you know, the perpetrator who injured you has been apprehended or not, you still have accomplices, and you have often have these triggers that, you know, will put you into a panic attack and give you symptoms consistent with anxiety. And if you already have any pre-existing mental issues, whether it's depression, anxiety disorder, bipolar disorder, or schizophrenia, that additional stressor is just gonna lower that threshold for which you're gonna wind up decompensating and having issues with. And so what we do, you know, and we often think about PTSD and post-traumatic stress for victims of war, but in areas that we live in and come from, particularly in New York City, Chicago, LA, you know, Oakland, even places like Poughkeepsie and Newburgh, New York, people who've been experiencing violent trauma their entire lives will suffer from PTSD, almost like war victims and survivors of war who are returning back home. And we want to make sure that we give them the tools that are going to help them develop protective factors that will allow them to get through their regular day. You know, nobody wants to be stuck in the house and, you know, having this fear of going out and having something bad happen to you. Nobody wants that feeling. And in our community, mental health is something that we don't often have access to. That's even more important. We don't talk about it. And so because we don't talk about it, we don't have access to it. And because we don't have access to it, we suffer with these symptoms and these conditions. In silence, and we self-medicate.
Yeah.
So we drink, we smoke, we pop pills, and we avoid anything just to suppress those feelings, those negative feelings and negative emotions. And so we want to make sure that there's a wellness practice that accompanies a lot of the work that we do, helping train people to, you know, even seek out counseling, introducing counseling and therapy in a, I don't want to say a traditional sense, but, you know, just having a healing circle per se. A lot of times, you know, I've been to therapy before, and I'm not ashamed to say it. You know, it's scary when you walk in that room and see that mental health professional, and you see that couch, and you see the chair where they sit in, and you're like, oh my gosh, I've hit rock bottom. And you know, it takes a lot of courage just to go there. Right. But, you know, for me, I have resources. I've talked about these kind of things. I have friends who are mental health professionals, so it's not like a big thing to, you know, even think about going to seek help yourself. But for most people, especially coming from marginalized spaces, we don't have access to that. And so a lot of the work that we do, we want to introduce the concept of mental health and introduce the concept of comprehensive wellness and help define those factors and figuring out what's our best. You know, I'm a physician, so I always think about like treatments. Yeah. You know, what's the best way to help treat these issues that you've been experiencing?
Perfect. So, you know, we all have the idea of what an emergency room situation is like. We've seen the movies, we've seen the TV shows, but take us through an emergency room night when you're on duty and the streets are hot. Okay. What's the worst situation you've seen?
There, you know, I get that question a lot. There, I think you just have to depend. It depends on the day, because I've seen worse, you know, really bad situations. I'll give you Thanksgiving. I worked Thanksgiving. And it was 19 degrees, and at 7:20 in the morning, 7:30 in the morning, I had a couple of patients coming in with gunshot wounds. 7:20 in the morning, 19 degrees. Then had another young man who came in sliced up, and you know, everybody had been injured before, and had been involved in some sort of situations in the past. And I'm like, yo, it's Thanksgiving, you know.
You would think it'd be calm, right? It's cold.
It's cold. The sun hasn't even really reached its full zenith, but this is something that's happening. Holidays, 4th of July weekend, anytime people are getting together, we expect them to be very happy and festive times, but these situations aren't always festive in the way, you know, you start mixing spirits together and spliffs, a very dangerous combination.
Right.
And you factor in somebody who's already been stressed, who's already been traumatized, little subtle things, somebody stepping on your shoe,
right.
Somebody accidentally talking to your significant other and didn't realize that, and you got this really volatile situation that occurs. And you and I were talking a little bit earlier about this time in Chicago.
Yeah.
Now, I grew up in Brooklyn, but I did my residency at Cook County Hospital in Chicago. And, you know, some of the stuff I saw when I was a resident there was something that's comparable to what you would see in a war movie. Sometimes you'd see young men and young women who are coming in, and they're victims and survivors, and then the family members. And when they're coming from the neighborhoods that you live in, or they're coming from a neighborhood that your family lives in, and my family's from the west side of Chicago, and I often would wonder, are my relatives going to come in? And sometimes my relatives did come in as patients, maybe not with violent injuries, but you know, everything from, you know, heart failure to substance abuse issues. And I always wondered if something happens, if it's the right night and the right day and the moon and everything is aligned, are they going to wind up being my patients? And that's something that I never wanted to experience. So, you know, looking at a lot of this stuff, particularly like with health and wellness and violent trauma, it impacts you very differently when you know where it's coming from and people look like you who are being impacted by it. And I started researching and doing a lot of work looking at, you know, what is violence? What is trauma? What is violent trauma? Why does it happen? What are the risk factors? And you know, how do we prevent people from becoming patients to begin with?
What conversations do you have with some of the victims who do come in, who are the survivors, who you can say, look, brother, you know, what are you doing with your life? What's that conversation like?
So it's funny you bring up from that perspective. It's not even about what are you doing with your life. The first question I ask is, are you okay? Because we look at it, you know, that you have different ways that people take care of violent trauma victims. You have the public health, which is looking a lot more preventative and, you know, incorporates a lot of the mental health services, making sure it doesn't happen again. And then you also have the law enforcement, which is kind of, you know, seek out, question, and remove that element from the situation, you know, in as best way possible. And sometimes that can even be violent. But a lot of patients who are coming through when they've been injured, or anybody coming to the ER, and I've been in the ER and been a physician for 16 years. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I go in there, I eat my lunch, I eat, you know, drink whatever I'm drinking that's legal during work. But I'm comfortable being in there. But it took time just to get comfortable being in there. Most people, when they think ER, when they even look at the hospital, they have these traumatic experiences. You know, they'll call the hospital the killer county. You know, they call, you know, they said that when I was at Cook County.
Yeah.
They said when I'm at Kings County.
Yeah.
Because they only know it as a place of violence and trauma. So asking somebody, are you okay?
Yeah.
Is a very powerful thing.
And I wonder if these young men have even heard that question before.
No, sometimes
know?
They don't, because yeah. when you say it to
yeah,
them,
they go, yeah, am I okay?
What do you mean I'm okay? It's like, they'd be like, no, I'm about to do this, and I'm about to do that.
They're like all over the place. I'm like, brother, I say, you are not okay.
Right.
You just got shot multiple times,
and I already can tell that you're anxious because I can hear it in your voice, and you're sweating.
Yeah.
And you're not having any withdrawal from anything.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like you were high off of heroin and you're going through withdrawal symptoms. You are anxious because of what happened, and it's okay.
Yeah.
And my job and our team's job is to make sure that you are okay, both while you are here and while you're outside. Mm-hmm. So if you have any questions about your care and treatment and don't feel comfortable, you let us know. You let me know, and I will make sure that we do our as best way possible so that you feel comfortable being here. And I was like, I'm going to keep coming back and asking you these questions. And sometimes, you know, they take a step back and they go, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And this is somebody that might be considered to be a volatile person,
right.
You know, and, you know, being anxious. And, you know, when, you know, we get to using certain colorful language, some of our counterparts don't always understand where that's coming
right.
from.
Right.
They may not be from the community. They may not understand that person's actual native language. You know, we're in a very large immigrant community in East Flatbush, and so people are coming in speaking
all kinds of variations,
Asian Creole, different African dialects, you know, different patois from throughout the Caribbean, Spanish, you name it, they're speaking it, and they're just looking for something to help bring in, you know, bring about a different level of ease
right,
and some
and familiarity.
So just asking, are you okay, is a very powerful statement. Then the next thing is, you know, what are those people? What do you need from us? How can we help you? As medicine, you know, we're very good at telling people what to do,
right.
But we don't always ask people what are your needs. You know, the patient doesn't care about diagnostic studies. They don't care if you're like, oh, we're gonna do this X-ray and we need to do this CAT scan and figure out the trajectory.
Better. Yeah.
They're like,
that's
man,
it.
I'm in pain.
Right.
I'm hurting. You gave me this morphine, which
right.
is helping with the pain, but now I'm throwing up all over the place. And I don't like throwing up
right.
all over the place.
Right.
So it's kind of like, okay, what do you need? How can I make you comfortable?
Okay.
And then you start looking and diving into some of the psychosocial needs.
Got it.
You know, we all need food, clothing, and shelter. Or we need some sort of sense of shelter or security in order to survive. And if any of those elements is compromised, your living situation is fluctuating.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to figure out how you're going to eat, how you're going to feed your family. Where you're gonna sleep tonight? Where your kids gonna sleep tonight? You know, how's
your priority shifts?
Yeah, your priority shifts.
All over the place, yeah.
You don't care about, you know, about an X-ray or about, you know, if somebody says you're gonna sign. If you sign out against medical advice, we're not gonna be held responsible.
Mm-hmm.
Don't care about that.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to survive. So you've got to help bring in people who understand the situation that they're going through, and are willing to help and go. Go the extra mile to ensure that person is safe. They're used to people giving up on them. They're used to people who are being very dismissive and not trusting them. But they aren't used to people who are providing a level of services and a level of deliverables that can really be life-changing.
Excellent. Thank you for doing that for the community because it's so much in need. Now, for those of us who are not in the New York City area and who really want to take advantage of a program like CAVI or, you know, need a program like CAVI, what do you tell those folks? What advice can you offer for young men, young women who are looking for that outlet and want to really find a way out of the hood?
Right. So one thing, we are a resource. And so if there are people who, you know, right now CAVI is only in Brooklyn, but we've done trainings in other parts of the United States. Whether it's a short lecture about trauma and trauma-informed care and mental health practices, that's something that we can also do. We do have participants who are in other parts of the country, either in college or working, and so they can also be a resource. But
Earlier, you and I were speaking about capacity building.
Absolutely.
The goal for us to do this work is to share ideas and help really build community in a level that we see fit, where people are in positions to thrive, and we are interested in helping train other people who are doing very similar kinds of work or want to do very similar types of work in their respective cities. And so they can check us out at kavibrooklyn.org. That's KAVIBROOKLYN.org. I was like, I can't forget how to spell Brooklyn. And that's like sacrilegious.
You wouldn't be able to go back.
No, you can go back. But we have an incredible team. I know people think, oh, you know, Gore, you know, that's, you know, he's the Kavi person. Yeah. He's the Kavi person.
But we have a very dynamic team of people who are dedicated to improving community well-being. And they're public health professionals. They're photographers. They're filmmakers. They're physicians. They are just concerned citizens that have an interest in overall comprehensive community well-being. We know the problems that exist, right. But now how do we create these different utopias in our respective environments?
Fantastic. Well, we have a couple of questions for you just because we're like so excited to have a medical professional in the room with so much experience. So definitely had a couple of questions for you just as a doctor. You know, it is extremely difficult to get Black men to see their primary care physicians. What advice can you give us, people who are sisters and mothers and wives and girlfriends who keep having these conversations but can't get through to these dudes? Like, go see a doctor. What advice can you give us?
One is this problem isn't going to be fixed overnight, and you have to be persistent.
Yeah.
You have to treat us almost like children.
Never heard that before.
and for people who have children or even an aging parent, yeah. You know, sometimes, you know, people are a little bit hard-headed.
Yes.
And so you have to keep drilling this home over and over again. You need to go to get checked out. And sometimes it's not even about, you know, people not wanting to go. They're terrified, mm-hmm. because they go, you know, well, what happens if they tell me I have something? Then what do I
right.
do? And so, you know, there were these billboards, you know, take your brother to the clinic day, take your husband or spouse to the clinic or to the hospital to get checked out. They had all these different campaigns that had come up. And a lot of times people just need somebody to go with them, because they are fearful of what can happen. You watch reality TV, you watch bad B movies, and you know, United Negro College Fund, you know, is talking about a mind is a terrible thing to waste, but the mind is a terrible thing to cultivate on its own sometimes,
yes.
because we start feeding into these psychoses. And if you've got other traumatized people,
yeah.
giving
their all
bad
this bad
advice,
yeah,
you've got this combination
right.
of bad advice
yeah.
that
festers, right?
It festers
yeah.
and then it blows up
yeah.
to the point where you only seek medical care when it's too late.
Absolutely.
And that's happened in my own family.
Yeah.
You know, you should never have to diagnose some sort of malignancy mm-hmm. in the emergency department when it's full-blown metastatic disease. And there are always exceptions, but, you know, like I've diagnosed, you know, it's not even just guys, it's
mm-hmm.
women too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had a patient pretty recently who had metastatic breast cancer, mm-hmm. which was diagnosed in the emergency department. People who've got metastatic prostate, guys who've got metastatic prostate cancer coming in with disease, you know, that spread throughout their bones and their chest and their abdomen and pelvis. And they knew they were losing weight, or they knew they were supposed to get screened. And these are, we're not even talking about people who've got limited formalized education.
Right.
We're talking about people who are college educated,
right.
master's educated.
Have health care.
Have health care. Have insurance.
Yeah.
Have you know, have a regular source of income
yeah.
and a disposable income.
Yeah.
So there's no reason why you think that they shouldn't, but
yeah.
because of a lot of personal fears
right.
that come along with healthcare, and it goes back to the original thing, people looking at healthcare as this place where you go
to die,
not really looking at what
to
is
get
comprehensive
well.
Wellness.
Right.
The whole
mm-hmm.
concept of wellness is thrown out of
yeah.
the window. So
yeah.
we've got to redefine what healthcare delivery. And a lot of that, the reason why the accessibility issue, I can't even blame the patients. I blame it on us, because
mm-hmm.
if we are failing to get a message out and people aren't taking this advice, it's because we're giving bad advice or we're giving misinformed advice and we're not really looking in the places and spaces that people actually need
mm-hmm.
us.
Okay, next question. Should we actually get the flu shot? Vaccinations? There's a lot of, you know, misconceptions out there. You know, people are saying lies. Is it lies? Is it true?
So So again, I'm an emergency physician, and I see extreme cases.
Yes.
I've seen plenty of people who've died from the flu, elderly, immunocompromised. You know, I've gotten the flu, and I thought I was dying. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm vegetarian. I do all sorts of holistic health stuff, too. But I get the flu shot because I've gotten it before,
and I'm a healthcare provider, and there are all sorts of different loopholes to get around it, wear a mask. But
I got stuff to do, and I need to make sure that I can do this stuff effectively. And I work in a very high-stress situation. Yes, you can, you know, the body is a miraculous vessel and can heal a lot of different things, but where, you know, when people, you know, a lot of times I hear the advice about not getting the flu shots, and I'm hearing this stuff from 20-something-year-olds and 30-something-year-olds and people who are, you know,
remote, you know, pretty healthy.
Mm-hmm.
When you start dealing with, you know, people who are elderly and immunocompromised, they're fighting off things in a very different fashion.
So I do encourage people to get the flu shot. I also recognize that people have their own viewpoints and they're going to do what they need, but you don't want to do this stuff when it's too late.
Right.
And, you know, from lost days at work, lost wages, having other illness.
Having childcare.
Childcare, you know, issues. Yeah. You know, like, I got a lot of stuff to do. I can't afford to be sick.
Exactly.
And the times I haven't gotten it, I've gotten the flu so bad, it's hemmed me up. And matter of fact, this year, I was hemmed up for 2 weeks because I hadn't gotten the flu shot yet.
Oh,
and I was just, my body just broke down. And I was like, you know what? I was like,
It's time
to go ahead and get it.
Yeah. Okay, so last question. It seems that Black women are at the top of a lot of diseases these days, right? Everything from heart conditions to heart disease to breast cancer, particularly diabetes, HIV, AIDS. Why? Why are we always the ones?
Yeah. One, it kind of comes back to we aren't as well informed.
Mm-hmm.
There's another thing about, you know,
you have, you know, accessibility to information, accessibility to early screening and early treatments.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we can get information out a lot earlier, you can start minimizing the lives that are negatively impacted by many different disease processes.
The other thing, you know, and Black women deal with on a level that's, you know, that's pretty crazy is stress. And stress has a major impact on disease. And an infection in the body or cancer itself is a type of stress. And so if you've got same thing, you know, you've got layers to this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've got pre-existing stress, you're not eating right, you're not sleeping properly, you've got
pre-existing medical conditions, diabetes, hypertension, and you have a family history on top of that, and you're not eating properly. These are all additional stresses on the body, which make a perfect breeding ground for certain types of illnesses to flourish.
Mm-hmm.
But the, you know, I think the best advice is to, you know, just get screened very early. You know, again,
going back to wellness, what does a wellness practice actually look like?
I think we assume that, you know, I guess because I took this garlic pill or, you know, I drank some apple cider vinegar that does, and, you know,
I'm good.
I did a master cleanse and I got all this stuff out of my system,
right,
then I'm going to be good. No. You know, I'm glad you're doing something. Whether or not that stuff works or not is that's another discussion.
It's like a foot long, yeah.
But if you're eating Popeyes and or I shouldn't say that. Actually, let's
back.
Well,
because you just had some Popeyes.
No, I don't eat that stuff. I learned early on if
you know I need to be in my most optimal state.
Yeah.
And if I'm putting food in my body, I mean, sweets and sugary stuff and greasy stuff and fried stuff and not sleeping properly, that's my only thing that I'm working on. There's a sleep issue. But if I'm not eating properly and taking care of myself, I get sick. And if I get sick, I can't do the things that I like to do. And I'm very physically active. I snowboard. I do Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Matter of fact, I'm going to train when we finish the interview. But I can't do that stuff if my body is hurting because of poor nutrition. You're going to get, you know, what you put into it, your body's going to let you know whether or not this is something that needs to be in there or not. And I'm also speaking from a place of privilege because I do have a disposable income where I can afford healthy foods. But there are healthy options. We just got to figure out how to train our bodies
and look for
those healthy options. It's
easy to walk into the Popeyes. It's not so easy to go to the organic juice place.
Right, but again, you know, if your main thing is I need to get rid of this hunger because my stomach hurts and you know, gassy, and I need to eat something, and I can't think straight because I don't have anything in my stomach. You're gonna go for that $2 option instead of going for something that's gonna cost $6.
Exactly.
Instead of getting a bottle of water, you can get one of the little bum waters or 10 sodas or something. because and I know and they still got them. I thought they didn't have them anymore. I went to one of the local bodegas and I'm like, oh, you still got this stuff. This stuff is disgusting. It's horrible for you, but you just want to feel good. Right. And you know, certain foods, you know, they will release certain chemicals in our bloodstream, and we have this heightened sense of euphoria,
and so we get good.
Yeah. And we're like, oh, yo, I feel good every time I eat this. But if you feel like when you wake up in the morning, obviously, wait, can I say
we'll edit it.
Sorry, but if you feel like crap, you know, when you eat this stuff the next morning, obviously that's your body telling you you need to get rid of that stuff. If you can't breathe, if you can't walk, and your joints are hurting, and your skin is
breaking out, and you look at all the stuff
that you're eating, and it's all completely toxic, you know.
1 + 1 = 2.
Yeah.
It makes sense. All right. Well, thank you so much. Let me first take the opportunity to say congratulations on being a CNN hero.
Oh, thank you.
The award celebration is this Sunday.
This Sunday.
And so we can't wait to watch, and we can't wait to see what happens. But congratulations on that honor.
It is an amazing one. We're excited about it.
Good.
Really excited.
Fantastic. Thank you again for joining us.
Thank you.